guys, it's Monica. I'm an internal medicine attending, and today I'm going to be talking about how to write notes efficiently, effectively, and accurately. So super high yield topic. And by the way, guys, I'm now on Instagram, so go over there and follow me for even more content. Now let's get started. So tip number one is don't use relative terms like today and tomorrow. Because if you do that, then the next day, the note is no longer accurate. So you want to make sure that you use exact dates, and that way you don't have to change it the next day or really ever. Tip number two, don't write the dosage of a medication more than once in your plan. So for example, let's say I have a patient who has heart failure and hypertension, and the patient's on lisinopril. Well, lisinopril serves two different purposes here. It's guideline-directed medical therapy for heart failure, and it treats hypertension. So let's say that you changed the dose of lisinopril that day. You don't wanna have to change the number twice in your plan because it's just gonna be easy to forget to change the second bullet point, and it takes more time. So what you wanna do is, whatever problem comes first, probably it's gonna be heart failure, then you'll say increase lisinopril to 40 milligrams daily, but then down further where you're putting hypertension, you can just say continue lisinopril, but no dose. So it's not inaccurate and you don't have to update that. Tip number three, use the words as above if part of your plan applies to two different problems. So this is the same concept as not writing the dosage of a medication twice. So for example, let's say you have a patient who has heart failure and an AKI, acute kidney injury, due to cardiorenal syndrome. So in that case, diuresis applies to both problems. So let's say you have heart failure as your first problem, and you write that you're going to give Lasix 40 milligrams IV that day. Well, you don't want to have to write it twice in your plan, or again, have to change the dosage of Lasix. So under AKI, you can write diuresis as above, because again, diuresis applies to both problems. Tip number four, have a discharge planning checklist. Now, discharge planning is kind of advanced for third year medical students, but it's good to at least understand what it is so that you know what's going on during rounds. So discharge planning starts when a patient's admitted, and it includes where the patient's gonna go after discharge, what medications you're starting that the patient's gonna need prior authorization for, whether or not the patient's going to need home health services set up, and what durable medical equipment the patient's gonna need. Now, durable medical equipment, DME for short, is gonna include things like a walker or shower chair, for example. Now, if all that sounds like Greek to you, don't worry about it. I'm gonna make a separate video on this topic, but just know that it is good to have a discharge planning checklist so that you're keeping track of discharge planning day by day. Tip number five, keep track of labs that take time to come back in your plan and then delete them when the results actually come back. So guys, please do this. This is a huge pet peeve of mine and it's actually very useful to you if you keep your plan accurate. So let's say you have a patient who's immunocompromised and comes in with acute hypoxic respiratory failure. So you're probably gonna send a million different labs, including the ones shown here. So this is what it would look like in your plan. And many of these labs take days to come back. So you wanna make sure that you have a list of them in your plan so that you remember each day as you're pre-rounding to check and see if those results came back. And if the result came back, you would put that in your results section and then remove the lab from your plan so you don't think that the lab is still pending and other people reading your note don't think that that lab is still pending. Plus, if it's updated every day, people are gonna know that you have high attention to detail and that your notes are accurate. Tip number six, reprioritize your problem list when appropriate. So guys, remember that the problem list is dynamic. Oftentimes, the problem list that you have when you're first admitting a patient is not gonna look the same on the last day of admission. So let's say you have a patient coming in with sepsis secondary to a UTI or urosepsis. So sepsis secondary to UTI would be the first problem on your problem list. And let's say you start antibiotics and the patient gets better, but on day three, the patient all of a sudden starts desatting and develops acute hypoxic respiratory failure, and let's say that you determine that this is due to aspiration. In that case, the patient is already doing better from a urosepsis standpoint, so that wouldn't be your first problem anymore. The thing that is most life-threatening to the patient at this moment is the acute hypoxic respiratory failure. So UTI, or sepsis due to UTI, is gonna drop lower down on your problem list, and then acute hypoxic respiratory failure due to aspiration pneumonitis or pneumonia is now gonna replace that and be the first problem on your problem list. Tip number seven, keep track of your antimicrobials in a list. So here's what my antimicrobial list looks like in my notes. Different people have different styles, but personally, I think that this is the cleanest way to do it. And notice that I'm saying antimicrobials, not antibiotics, because remember, it's semantics, but it's important. Antimicrobials treat multiple different types of organisms, including bacteria, fungi, viruses, etc., whereas antibiotics refer to medications that treat bacteria specifically. And so if you're going to be treating multiple different possible organisms, then you want to make sure you label your list as antimicrobial list. Now that's just a side note, but you do want to keep track of these because if the patient is hospitalized for weeks, let's say, the person who's inheriting that patient from you is going to know what antimicrobials the patient got earlier in the hospitalization. And when you're writing the discharge summary, it's really helpful to have that list as well, so you're not going back through your charts to try to figure out what medications that the patient received while the patient was admitted. Tip number 8, don't put results in the plan section. Please, this is another pet peeve of mine. It's just gonna clutter up your plan and make things more confusing. So the results go in the results section. If the result goes into your assessment plan, it's actually gonna go in the assessment because you're using that result in your clinical reasoning to explain what you think is going on. It's nice to keep your plan clean and organized, so in summary, please don't clutter it with results. And lastly, and this is a really high yield tip, make sure you take advantage of dot phrases and note templates. So dot phrases refer mostly to Epic if you use that as your electronic medical record, but most electronic medical records will have some sort of keyboard shortcut for things that you're gonna type really often. Now you don't wanna be in the hospital for hours every evening finishing up your notes. You want to make them as efficient as possible. So use dot phrases or keyboard shortcuts for things that you find yourself typing every day. So things you want to use dot phrases or note templates for are going to be listed here. So for example, the review assistance for the subjective, because every day you're going to say things like patient denies chest pain, shortness of breath, fever, chills, blah, blah, blah. And you don't want to have to keep typing that out every single day. So have a dot phrase for that. And then you want to have in your note template a normal physical exam, so all you have to do is update the abnormals each day. And finally, you're going to want an inpatient checklist at the bottom to remember whether or not you have the patient on fluids, whether or not the patient should still be on DVT prophylaxis or GI prophylaxis, etc. Thank you guys so much for watching. I want to give you guys a quick list of videos that are upcoming so that you make sure that you subscribe and hit the notification bell so that you're notified when those videos go up. Now, these are super high yield topics that are coming up, so be sure to subscribe. And again, you can follow me on Instagram and TikTok as well. Bye, guys.